We are officially live streaming, so remember there is a hot mic in the room. So if you are going to talk that smack, be careful, be smart about talking that smack because people might hear you, might come back.
Ew, I hate Mahan.
There you go.
Oh, sorry, did you hear that?
Right. All right, so first up and foremost, big idea number five, it's all about thermo and the state, the changes of matter or state changes of matter. So here we go. So heat is always given what? How is heat always transferred? Anytime two objects touch, heat is always transferred from? Nice. Heat is always transferred. Always transferred from the hot or the object that has high energy, high heat, right? From the hot, I'll put it in parentheses or in quotes, to the cold, all right? When two objects touch, that's why there's no such thing as cold, right? That's why I'm going to put that in parentheses as well. There's really no such thing as cold. You either have heat or you're lacking heat. So every time you touch an object, if it feels cold to you, it's stealing your heat energy. If it feels warm to you, you're stealing its heat energy, right? Heat is always coming and going. Here's a biggie, and this is one that a lot of people got wrong on the final as well, right? The quantity, the amount or quantity of heat or of energy transferred is always equal, all right? Is always equal. What's the only thing that's different about the heat energy or this idea of energy being transferred?
Heat capacity.
Heat capacity, we'll get to that all the way over there on the right. Very good. Heat capacity is why the change in temperature will be different, but the sign is different, right? So maybe I am gaining 100 kilojoules. Well, then that means the object is losing 100 kilojoules. So like the final exam had a question about a hot piece of metal being put into water. The thermal energy transferred between the two is the same amount of energy. The water does go up less degrees than the metal goes down, but that's because of heat capacity, and we'll come back to that. All right, yes?
So they're the same, but just opposite.
Correct. It's exactly the same. Always the same. Heat energy is always the same quantity. It's always the same amount, just different signs or opposite signs. Okay, so it's always, the quantity of energy is always equal. And that's hard to wrap our brains around. But that's literally what we have going on, right? Because energy cannot be created or destroyed. All right, heat capacity, which we kind of, you know, Kate is already in my brain. Heat capacity is the reason for different changes in temperature. Is the reason that delta T will be different. So even though the amount of energy that I give or take is the same, the actual change in temperature will be different due to that thing called heat capacity, which we have all the way over there at the end of this board under the guise of what we call calorimetry, okay? First and second law of thermodynamics. First law of thermodynamics is what about energy? I was just kind of alluding to it. Energy
cannot be created or destroyed.
Very nice. Cannot be created, nor destroyed, okay? And so really, what does that mean? That just means this data point right here, this piece of knowledge, that point that we have right there, right? It cannot be created or destroyed. It can only be transferred. And really what that also allows us to do, and we'll get into that, I kind of have it set up all the way over there, is just that the delta H of the system is going to be equal to but opposite that of the surroundings. And almost always, we're always measuring the surroundings, and so we know if the surroundings has absorbed 100 joules of energy, that means the system must have released 100 joules of energy. If the surroundings loses 150 joules of energy, the system must have absorbed it. So delta H of the system equals negative delta H of the surroundings. And again, coming back to our data point or our first point up here. All right, second law of thermodynamics, that's spontaneity, right? That the universe is always moving, is always becoming more random, AKA getting bigger, is always becoming more random. And if you saw the news articles, I didn't read them yet, I see the headlines, but Stephen Hawking's last book is like, I believe, a proponent of the idea of the multiverse. So man, you want to talk about randomness, right? So what did that mean in reality? What do we need to know? That the delta S is always positive, right? And that's why we always want positive randomness, and we always want positive entropies in order to be what we call thermodynamically favorable.
Delta H of the system, is that always positive, or is it just...
No, it could be either or. Could be negative,
part
and then that would mean...
What's
that?
Part of Rick.
Yeah. Is he?
Yeah.
He's jealous that... he's probably jealous that I got some of the top students here right now. You hear that, Carbo? I'm live streaming hot mic. I don't care, Carbo. Whatever. I do what I want. Okay. No, I'm just kidding, Carbo. You know I love you. Just on weekdays. All right, standard conditions, standard temperature, standard pressure, all that fun stuff. Anybody remember what standard pressure is? Standard pressure is?
1 ATM.
1 ATM, right? That would be 1.0 ATM, which also equals 760 millimeters of mercury. They usually give you the 1 ATM on the reference sheet somewhere. They usually write at the top, like right under where it says reference sheet. They usually have like STP, and they have standard temperature, standard pressure. But just keep in mind that, yes, my son's ordering pizza, but I went and picked it up. Yes, but I went and picked it up. Okay, sorry. Oh. What's standard temperature? 0 degrees Celsius, right? Which, and again, when you get the test on test day, check this number out. Some years they give you 7273. Some years they give you 273.15. Oh, man, March just skipped a beat. All right, they sometimes give you 273, sometimes 273.15. But make sure, make a mental note to check that on test day so that you know for your sig figs as you do the math. This is one thing that we kind of maybe mentioned throughout the year, but probably not exactly or formally, so here we go. As far as standard concentration is considered, if we make a standard galvanic cell, if you have a solution of standard concentration, if you wanted to make a hydrochloric acid at standard concentration is always 1 molar, okay, 1.0 molar. That's actually a very, very high concentration in the land of this thing called solutions, right? Here's another little fun fact. I don't really see this too often at all, but it's in my review and it's in the stuff that I've read in review books, so why not put it out there? That delta HF, when you deal with like Hess's law, which is coming up, if they don't give you the delta H for a pure substance, just like what we actually discussed when we went over reduction potentials, and we were talking about oxidation number, we said if it's in its pure state, what's the oxidation number if it's in its pure state? It is zero. Well, guess what? Delta H for a pure substance is 0.0 kilojoules per mole. If we're talking about something in its normal state of matter, if we're talking about oxygen as a gas, we can't form oxygen gas. It just is the way that it is, right? When the way that we end up at, well, we can form it, I'm misspeaking there, it does actually end up always being zero. All right, so those are the standard conditions. Again, most of the time that stuff is on the reference sheet, but just in case, I do sometimes see them expect you to know some of that information, but check the top of your reference sheet, that's what it would be. I kind of already gave this away, but heat of formation, we were discussing this in class. We were discussing this the last thing. What do we got for delta H? What are the units always for delta H? Delta H is always either joule or no. Did you check with Carbo?
Yeah.
He's already got his too?
Yeah. What could this be?
I don't know. Oh. I don't know. Maybe make see if maybe Mr. Brown will make an all call or something. I don't know. Otherwise, it's yours, guys. All right. It's always going to be mole or kilojoule or joule per mole. Right. So keep in mind that enthalpy is always like per mole. Right. What is enthalpy in reality? What is the heat of formation in reality?
Do you know what Nancy?
Nancy. Nancy Clark, but I don't think she's doing anything. Yeah, she's not doing anything. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe try to see if they'll do like an all call. I know Broderick's still around. Maybe they'll do an all call and say, please come get you. Nancy. You guys know more teacher first names than I do, so. Alright, so what is the heat of formation, what is enthalpy, what is all that fun stuff, right? It's the amount of heat energy that is released, or if it's not released, it has to be Absorbed. Very nice. It's the amount of energy that's actually heat or absorbed as the reactants become products, right? As the reactants separate and become products, right? And form new species, new things that we call products. So it's your overall amount of energy. What's the actual cost? All right, what's your actual cost? I don't care what you had to begin with. I don't care how much it was. I don't know. I don't care how much you made your front. I want to, what's the bottom line? What did it actually end up causing us, right? What did it end up costing us? So delta HF, if it's a negative, what does that mean, ladies and gentlemen? If it is a negative, that means that the forward, right? We're going to sneak in a little equilibrium here. Forward is very good. It's exothermic, right? Exo, exit. We have, our bugs have exoskeletons, right? So that means on the outside or to leave. How about in terms of thermodynamic favorability? Is delta H being negative? Is that thermodynamically favorable?
Yes.
Like, yeah, dude, this is definitely thermo favorable, right? You cannot use the term spontaneous anymore. It gets you zero points.
Wait,
on
no.
The, well, yeah, if you're going to talk about something happening normally or on its own, you can't use spontaneous in your open-ended explanations. They don't accept that. No. Thermodynamically favorable. Right? An ice cube. If I were to take an ice cube out right now and put it on the desk, what would happen?
It would probably melt.
It would probably melt, right? That's called a thermodynamically favorable process right now at this temperature.
Doesn't it? Okay. Would you still call it thermal favored if it was favored based on delta S?
Yes, same idea. It's also thermodynamically favorable based on entropy. There was a question like that on the test that a lot of people got beat up on.
It is thermodynamically favorable. It's spontaneous.
It is spontaneous, yes.
But you just did
but
a different word.
The problem is 2 years ago they said people with spontaneity with entropy, they were confusing that with spontaneity all the time. And people are just using, oh, it's spontaneous, it's spontaneous, spontaneous. So the people at College Board said that's not good enough that you explained to us what that really means. So they wanted you, and they changed it over from spontaneous to thermodynamically favorable, or it is thermodynamically favorable. How about if it's positive? What does that tell you? That tells you that the forward is
endo.
Nice. The forward is endo, right? It's going to cost more money. We have to put more money into it than we're going to get out. I buy a house, I try and fix it up, and I sell it for a loss. That was an endothermic. I ended up putting money into that. That is not thermodynamically favorable. Right, but again, we're going to sneak in a little bit of equilibrium here, even though that's not till big idea six. If the forward, if delta H is negative, that means the forward's exo. What does that tell you about the reverse? The reverse is actually endo, right? Same thing, delta H being positive, forward is endo. That means the reverse is
exo.
And same thing, but opposite for the thermo, right? Thermodynamic favorability. Forward is exo, it's favorable. Reverse endo, not favorable. Vice versa, right? Vice versa. So just a quick... just top-down scratch view at what delta H is. Remember that this formula is on your reference sheet. I know we've gone over this a bunch in class, but here it is again. If it's delta HF, it's products, right, minus the summation of the delta HF of the reactants, okay? If we are talking about delta HF, then another way that we can actually calculate delta H, and we'll bring this up again when we get over there to calorimetry, is because calorimetry, or Q, the amount of actually specific heat related to this reaction we're looking at, delta H is going to be Q divided by moles. Again, how do I keep that in mind, or how do I remember that? Well, what is the unit for H? H is not just joules, not just kilojoules, it's joule or kilojoule per mole. And we're going to see when we get over there that that's what Q is. Okay, that's what Q is. Now, we've gone over this ad nauseum, so we're just going to rip through this real quick. Right, delta H for bonds, bond enthalpy, bond energy. It's the same idea, delta H, but it's only for bonds. All right, so it's the energy, but only for the bonds in one molecule, right? One molecule, one compound, one species. Okay, we're not looking at the actual reaction. So these are not related to reactions. These are simply just looking at bonds being made or bonds being formed. When bonds are broken, what do we need to do in order to break bonds? Very good. Breaking bonds is always positive, right? Energy in, we would call that endothermic. And when we form bonds, what happens when we form bonds? Energy is released, right? Or AKA exothermic. So we've gone over that a bunch in class. We've done that a bunch, et cetera, et cetera. All right, moving on to Hess's Law. Hess's Law, okay? Now, Hess's Law is kind of like what we did for this idea of voltage and kind of what we were doing with the idea of reaction mechanisms. All right, so Hess's Law says that delta H for a reaction can be calculated by adding up the individual, or the delta H of each step in a reaction. All right, for the delta H of each step for a reaction, right? Or AKA a reaction mechanism, right? And we went over reaction mechanisms on Tuesday night. On Tuesday night, we were talking about how we would have the possibility of multiple steps that would have to add up and give us the balanced overall chemical equation. Remember doing that a little bit? Maybe you do, maybe you don't, if you're Tuesday. So what will happen with these Hess's Law type problems? This was that XYZ, this was the VWTUVWXYZ question on the final. Remember those questions?
Yeah.
Everybody hated those? Here it was. Here's Hess's Law. Right? So here we go. Hey, don't worry, everybody.
Yeah, that was so annoying. That was so annoying.
I did
it. It's the second time you did that to me
today.
So upset.
So sad. That's what it was. Right. So here's what they'll do to you. They'll give you a reaction, or like you saw on the final. They'll give you random reactions, and they'll ask you, like, how can you hodgepodge them together? But I want to take these three and somehow add them up to get the balanced equation, right? And what they'll give you is they'll give you the reaction mechanism. You never have to actually create the reaction mechanism. And while giving you the reaction mechanism, they may also, or they probably will also give you the individual delta H's for each individual step, right? So they tell me that this first step or this first reaction, somebody had done that reaction, they analyzed it, they monitored it, they did all that fun stuff, and they found that the first reaction was a positive, so it was endothermic, positive 180.6 kilojoules per mole, right? The second one, we monitored it, we measured it, we collected data, the negative, et cetera, et cetera. So what my job to do is to take these three and maybe flippy floppy, maybe multiply, and when I flippy floppy and multiply, I modify the delta H accordingly. So what do I want to do to the first reaction? What do I want to do with the first reaction? Do I want to modify it, or do I want to leave it as is?
You want to leave it as is.
Why do you want to leave it?
Because
no. The O2.
Oh, yeah, that's good.
But why do you want to leave it? Two reasons.
No,
O2. O2 and... And L. However, okay, so I don't want to flippy floppy this, but in looking at the O2, well, I also see some O2 down here, so I'm a little weary about multiplying just yet. But what do you notice here? I have NO here, and the NO matches up here. But what's the problem with the NO and the NO? In the balanced equation, I need, and here I only have, is there any other NO anywhere in my reaction mechanism?
NO.
Nope, right? Nope. So, what do I got to do to get that 2 to become a 4? I have to
multiply
by what?
2.
2, so I multiply the entire thing. You've got your 2. So I'm going to actually rewrite this because I want to clean it all up down here. So I'm going to write 2N2 gas plus 2O2 gas yields 4NO. Now, when I do that, right, when we went over reduction potentials the other night, did we multiply the reduction potentials? Did we multiply the voltages?
No,
you never multiply voltages ever. Don't ever do it. But do you think we should multiply delta H values?
Yes.
Yes, we should. Why? What's in this unit?
Moles.
So currently, as this was stated, this was for 2 moles. This is how much I got. But I don't want to know for 2 moles. I want to know for 4. And so if I doubled everything, I got to double my delta H, and we didn't flip it, so it stays positive. 6 times 2 is 12. Carry the 1. 2 times 0 is 0, but carry that 1. Then we have 3, 6 to fill it out, right? So again, we have our 361.2, right? I think that's correct. Just trying to do it off the top of my head, right? What do I want to do the second reaction? Do I want to flippy floppy the second reaction?
Yes,
you do. Why? What'd you see?
The NH3.
Aha! Check out the NH3 right here. Check out the little NH3 right here. So I want to flip it. Do I want to do anything else to it after I flip it or while I flip it?
Multiply by 2.
What do I want to do? I want to
multiply by 2.
Why do you want to multiply by 2?
So it'll be 4.
4 going in. Got to get that to be 4. There's no other NH3s here. So I'm thinking flippy floppy and I'm thinking times two. So I'm going to flip this and multiply at the same time. So I now have four NH3s actually going in, and they are of the gas variety. I have two N2s coming out, and that's of the gas variety. I have six hydrogens coming out, and so I have to multiply this by two, but also, what do I have to do to this? Not only do I have to multiply this by two, but since I flipped it, I have to
flip the sign.
So that times two, I would get a six, carry the one, two times one is two, plus one is three, and nine times two is 18. But again, now that's going to be a positive kilojoules. And actually, we can drop the mole here, because when we multiplied by that two and et cetera, we ended up with the mole. We're multiplying by mole, so you can drop the mole if you want. All right, what do I want to do to the third one? Leave it, but what do I want to do to it? I want to multiply by what?
Three.
Multiply by three. Again, the way I saw that, a hydrogen or dihydrogen monoxide phenomenon, aka water. So if I multiply by three, I got my six H2s going in. I have my three O2s going in. I have my six H2Os coming out. And I didn't flippy floppy, so I keep it negative. I multiply by three, one, carry the two. 1, carry the 1, 4, so 5 times 2, carry the 2, 1451, I think, 1451, 1, and that would be kilojoules, and I leave it in the negative variety, okay? So now I check, if I do add these all up, do I get the balanced equation I was looking for? Well, as I add these up, what I like to do is look at my reactant side, compare it to my product side, and eliminate as is or as needed. Now, where the hell did this N2 come from? This was another question that a lot of people got wrong on the test, on the vinyl, right? This N2, and all of a sudden it's here in the beginning. And then all of a sudden it's being made over here, but it's not my balanced equation. What do we call things that start in the reactants, end in the products, but actually aren't even in the balanced reaction? Those are called?
Catalysts.
Very good. This N2, and there's two of them, that's a catalyst. It's not an intermediate. Yeah. In the presence of the chlorine, it went faster.
Does like legit like speed up the rate
yeah.
of reaction?
Yeah. Speeds up our reaction without being
like
consumed
the,
by
like
the reaction. It speeds it up by lowering the activation energy.
Yeah.
Right?
Like I put it.
Right. All right. How about O2? Is there any O2 on the product side at all?
Oh, yeah.
No. On the product side? Oh, we're talking about something. Okay. So is there any O2 on the product side? No, but there is more O2. There is actually 2 moles here, 3 moles here. What's 2 plus 3, ladies and gentlemen? That is 5-piece McNuggets. There's my 5 moles of oxygen. So now I'm going to go to my next reaction, or my next reactant, 4 NH3. Any NH3 on the product side? No. Any other NH3 in the reactant side? No. So there goes my 4 NH3s. Loving it. That's exactly what I wanted in the balanced equation. Go to your third little mini equation, 6 H2s coming out. Ooh, but we had 6 H2s made up here, so they cancel out. What do we call things that are products first and then used as reactants later? They're not catalysts, but
intermediates.
Man, look at that. Yeah, what'd you look at, right? We already took care of our oxygens, so that's my reactant side. Looking really good. It's the same reactants coming out on the product side, right? Coming out on the product side. I was looking, I have 4 NOs, which actually is exactly what I wanted, booyah kasha. Along with that, I have my 6 H2Os, exactly again what I was looking for. And so I have all of the reactants and all the products I was looking for. So at this point, we would just very simply, since all I did was squishy squishy, all I did was add this to get that, I would just add my positive 361.2 to my positive 183.6. to my positive 140 or 1451. Anybody got a calculator and do
whatever?
What is it? Yep.
So
361.2 plus 183.6.
Negative
906.3. And the unit that would be left over is kilojoules. So you find delta H. So far we found three ways. Doing the reaction for, or the equation with sigma for actual heat of formation. We learned and we discussed how for bonds it's backwards, B for bond, B for backwards. So it would be the same overall idea of math but backwards, or you could use Hess's law. Okay, or you could use Hess's law only if they give you the reaction mechanism. Question.
Kind of related, but like, what does an intermediate actually do?
It's just a hypothetical idea that it's there.
So it doesn't do anything?
No, but you could look at it this way. The intermediate is the way at which, because without this intermediate, without this H2, This oxygen would never react with the H2 to create water. So they're important, they're there, but you know, when you meet the person of your dreams, right, the person that hooked you up, are they really that important? No, right, it's just me and them forever. But the but without that person, without that issue, right, you never would have met them, you never would have bumped into them, never would have happened.
Is the intermediate the one that makes the valley in the graph? Is that
yes,
else?
Yes,
okay.
That's the valley in the energy curve graph. Yep, yep. All right, moving on, phase changes, sublimation, melting, evaporation. All three of these things are similar. Why? Anybody know what's the similarity between the three? They are the three phase changes that require what with energy? Energy to go in. These are all endothermic. Heat's got to go in. These are all the endothermic phase changes. You have to put energy into an ice cube to get it to melt. That's why your hand feels cold when you... My back feels cold when you drop one in my back. That's why. Right? Flip side to that, condensating... or condensation, or condensation, dirt, freezing, and deposition, they are all?
Exothermic,
right? They all, we have to give off energy. That's why, as your cup in the summer is sitting near that ice glass of, oh my God, ice water, I can taste it now. That glass of ice water, as the condensation's forming on it, the ice is melting inside your cup because the air particles are slamming into your cup, donating their heat to the cup. That energy is going through the cup into your liquid. That energy is going through the liquid into your ice cube and then melting the ice cube. Crazy. All right, these are what are called heating and cooling curves, right? You have multiple spots on heating and cooling curves. You have A, B, C, D, E, and F. You did not go over these in this class. You go over them in Chem 1, though. Okay, you go over them in Chem 1, though. From A to B, what's A to B? Anybody know what's going on from A to B?
No.
Solid only, and what's happening to temperature, what's happening to the overall energy of the molecules from A to B. A to B, it's a solid only, and the solid is actually heating up, all right? Increase in temperature. T goes up. How about from B to C? Anybody know what B to C is? What is it?
Melted.
From B to C, when you see heating and cooling curves, when you see plateaus, those are the phase changes. When you see a plateau, that's the phase change. So you should know what states of matter are present when melting is occurring, what two states of matter are present? Solid and liquid, right? Now, once that last little bit of ice in your cup finally melts, bang, now the temperature takes off again and goes up. So from C to D, you have a liquid only and temperature goes up. Wait a minute, let's come back here and let's look at B and C real quick. Notice how it's a plateau and it's flat. So what does that tell you about temperature? Temperature is actually constant, right? But all that energy is going into breaking IMFs, breaking intermolecular forces. If you actually took a flamethrower, a lighter, a heat source, and you put a heat source under an ice cube, the ice cube actually does not get warmer at all while it's melting. The ice cube actually stays at exactly 0 degrees Celsius. All the energy you're putting into it is making the molecule move faster and faster to break that hydrogen bond, that dipole-dipole, or that London dispersion. Once the last little bit of ice cube melts and now it's all liquid, bang, now all the energy is making the molecule move faster. All right, so then what's D to E? D to E on a heating curve is, what's the next phase change? Melting to evaporation. Beautiful. And what are the two gases, what are the two states of matter that are present at evaporation? Liquid and gas. Believe it or not, as you boil water, water actually never changes temperature. Stays at a constant 100 degrees Celsius. As you're heating it to make your macaroni, even all of that fire and all the bubbling and all the craziness, it's staying at exactly 100 the entire time. All the energy that you're putting it on your gas burner or your electric burner at home, again, all of that energy is going into breaking those intermolecular forces. Steam is actually hotter than boiling water. Steam actually has a higher energy, a higher temperature than water does. From E to F, you have gas only, and again, you can see the temperatures going up. Steam is actually hotter than boiling water. If you ever got punished and you had to put your hand in steam or boiling water, put it in the boiling water. That's
oh my
a
God,
wicked,
that's
wicked,
not, I've never heard of that.
Whatever, it is what it is, right? We see almost all the same things but opposite on a cooling curve. Why is it called a cooling curve? Because you're not constantly putting heat in, you're constantly taking heat out, right? So a heating curve is actually endo. That would represent, this heating curve represent those three states of matter we just discussed. The cooling curve is actually exo. So what do you think you got from A to B on a cooling curve? On a cooling curve from A to B, you have only, what's the highest temperature state of matter?
Gas.
Gas, right? So this is gas only, but as I take energy out, temperature is consistently going down. Okay? Now, what's B to C? Anytime you see a plateau, that means phase change. What's the phase change that a gas undergoes?
Condensation.
Right? Technically, you could also do deposition or deposit. I don't know if I want to use the word making. I'm going to say creating IMFs. So actually on those plateaus, the temperature doesn't change because as the molecules slam into your cup, your ice water cup, they're slowing down and actually starting to create intermolecular forces. The molecules slow down enough, now they start to get attracted to each other, and we start to create IMFs. We don't change temperature at all. All right, C to D, what's the only state of matter present C to D? Now that we've condensed, the only state of matter C to D is
liquid.
And again, as we continually cool it down and cool it down and take energy out, it's going to cool down and cool down. How about D to E? Another plateau means another phase change. What phase change does a liquid normally undergo? Freezing, right? Freaking freezing. Freaking freezing. Freezing, and again, we're going to be creating IMFs as that goes. And the only state of matter present from E to F is the solid. And yes, there is something cooler than ice cold. All right. Okay. Right? And that's probably something you haven't heard in quite a while. Not the outcast graph, but the actual like heating and cooling curves. We did go over phase diagrams in class. We did have that one good old little worksheet that we kind of worked on. And the left or the y-axis is normally pressure, and the x-axis is normally temperature. These are the diagrams where we've collected all of the data points, and each of these lines represents a phase change. Each of these lines represent a phase change. Phase diagrams are solge. That's a way to remember what the different states of matter are on a phase diagram. Solge. This area above this curve and to the left of this curve, those are all of the pressure and temperatures you sunk my battleship to find a solid. This area between these two curves is all the pressure and temperature parameters to find things as a liquid. This is all very high temp, very low pressure. That's where we find gases. Anybody remember we call this dot in the middle? That's a very important dot, the one in the middle. That is the
triple.
Nice, that's a TP. That's the triple point. All right, triple point. Triple point is the point at which the magical pressure and temperature that you could actually get all three states of matter to exist at the same time. All right, that's what we call the triple point. All three states of matter exist at the same time. Anybody remember what that point right there is called?
End point? Guessing?
Kind of.
Okay.
That's what point it is.
Should have quit while I was ahead.
This is what we call the critical point.
That's what I meant.
Yeah. Point right? The point at which it doesn't matter how much pressure, how much pressure you put the object under. At a certain temperature, the object will always end up then therefore being a gas. All right. So the critical point, pressure doesn't matter anymore. It's always going to be a gas. It's the temperature at which pressure, doesn't matter how much pressure you put it under, it's always going to end up being a gas. Now, things that are very interesting about phase diagrams is that that phase diagram is actually a very special phase diagram. This left curve right here only happens and only occurs for water. Every other object that we've ever evaporated, condensed, melted, froze, sublimated, deposited, all others look like this. Water is the only one that has this wicked weird curve, right? So for the solid reverse line, that's for water. Anybody remember why water has that wicked weird curve that goes in the opposite direction? What's so special about water? What kind of intermolecular forces is that?
Hydrogen bonds.
It's those hydrogen bonds that give it this weird curve. This dotted line is everything else, right? Everything else, actually, as you heat it and cool it and all that fun stuff, we'd see a curve go that way. Yes.
What about other things with hydrogen bonds?
No, water's the only one because it's the only one that does double. Good guess, though. The other ones, I would imagine that they're probably more like this. The other hydrogen bond stuff, they're kind of like somewhere in the middle. But waters is the only one that like actually like goes off to the left. Good question, though. I like that sound.
Listen, when you don't have friends, you gotta make a lot of noises so that like you can have different people in your life. What? I mean, huh?
Okay. Q equals MC delta T. Anytime they talk to you about calorimetry or bomb calorimetry or anything of that nature, you need to go to Q equals MC delta T. It's under the thermal unit in your reference sheet. Q equals what? Q is quantity of heat. Q is the pure actual energy that's related in the reaction, whether it's absorbed, whether it's released. Q for quantity. Q for quantity. It's the quantity of heat that's actually either released or absorbed. And again, we're always measuring the surroundings. We're always measuring the water in calorimetry, so that's why I have that as our last one. Anybody remember what little m is? Not half of the greatest candy ever if you put a peanut in the middle of it. Yeah, there you go. Mass. Right? And what unit are we going to have for mass? Mass is usually in grams, right? So I'll even put like the joules up here. For the quantity of heat. C, anybody know what C is? Ooh, you remember the real word too. Specific heat capacity. Specific heat capacity, right? This is why when you go to the beach, the sand is scorching hot, the air is scorching hot, I can't breathe. But then you go and you run in the water, you're like, oh my God, it's so hot, I'm sweating. And you run and jump in the water, and oh my God, it's so cold! You come running back out, you're freaking freezing. This is why, you ever notice how long does it take for the ocean water, the Atlantic Ocean here, to warm up? Like, what month is it finally warm?
September.
July, August, September. September, we're back at school. It can go to the beach. Get rid of the sand, get rid of the sun, and go up the beach. Let's go. Specific heat capacity. It's how much energy, right? It's how much energy. If I gave everybody right now a Red Bull, would we all react the same? We'd all probably get a little bit more excited, but would we all get to the same level? No, right? More excited than this? Imagine. My fourth period one class, every once in a while, I get like the Starbucks, I get like an espresso.
Sometimes.
Okay. So specific heat capacity, right? If I give everybody right now a Red Bull, we'll all get excited, but we won't get to the same level. That's why when you drop a hot piece of metal into water, even though the energy that the water is gaining is equal to the energy that the hot piece of metal is giving me, the metal might go from 100 degrees down to 20, but the water will only go from 10 to 15. Water has a huge heat capacity. Water has a ginormous amount of energy needed in order to get it to actually go up 1 degree. So heat capacity is usually either joules or kilojoules per gram or kilogram times degree Celsius or Kelvin. You have to look at the units given to you by C. It's kind of like when you do ideal gas laws type work and you look at R. You have to look at the unit, whether you have to convert temperature or not. Delta T is what? Delta T is?
Change in temperature.
All right, change in temp. And how do you always calculate all changes? It's always what minus what? It's always? Very nice. TF, T final, minus TI, not T big. Versus T small. T-I, you're not small. I like you, man. You're actually pretty good. Place your Mac. Get back on the scene, man. Get back on the scene. All right, TF minus TI. It's not necessarily just the higher temperature minus the smaller temperature. It's what did you end at minus what you began at. Yes?
So just back to the heat capacity.
Mm-hmm.
If it has a larger heat capacity, it's harder to heat up.
Exactly. And it's also harder to cool down.
Wait.
It's also harder to cool down. That's one of the things we never really think of. Right, you get that brand new like case of water, case of Snapple, Gatorade, right? And you bought it and it's room temp and you want it to be cold. It takes freaking forever to get it to be cold. That's the other reason why, because water has such a high heat capacity. It's hard to heat up, it's hard to cool down. That's why in elite PC gaming, they use it as a coolant because it can absorb a lot of energy and all that fun stuff. That's why all of our materials that we cook with are made of metals, because they allow that sea of electrons, allow the energy to pass real quick. So they heat up real fast, cool down real fast, right? Good question. Okay. Getting back to what we were talking about with the delta H, same thing with the Q. You are almost always going to actually measure from the surroundings. We always measure the temperature of water. So it's very important that you do TF minus T initial, because what we get for Q is usually the Q of the surroundings, but that's just equal to but opposite that of the system. And once you find the Q of the system, if you just divide that by moles, guess what? You just calculated delta H. So there's the fourth way to calculate delta H. If you take the Q of the system, which is equal to but opposite that of the surroundings, there you go.
For like questions, like calorimetry questions, I always struggle with like knowing if you're doing like the surroundings or the system.
You're always, anytime they talk to you about the water change temperature, it's always the surroundings.
Okay.
Always the surroundings, it's the water. The thing that sometimes also gets very weird is when they're talking about mass. What are we measuring? Do I add the mass of the reactant with the mass of the water? If it's something that will dissolve into the water, or if it's two liquids that are going to dissolve and react together, two aqueous, add the masses. If it's the question from the final, piece of metal in water, does the metal dissolve into the water? No. So because the metal doesn't dissolve into the water, you take just the mass of water.
Okay,
just the mass of water.
We're never going to ask about chemistry, if one of them changes states, does that have to physics?
Yeah, no, we don't, yeah. Yeah, no, that's physics. That's PCAM. That's the greatest chemistry of all time when we mix physics with chemistry. We're talking about that in Mini Club today. A little bit. We're getting into that. Something fun about mass. You guys know the density of water?
It's 1/1.
Yeah, the density of water is water, again, one of the magnificent, crazy, just radical Fibonacci sequence things of the universe. Every 1 milliliter of water is 1 gram, and every 1 gram of water is exactly 1 milliliter. It's freaky. Why? How the hell does that work? It just does. Right? That's why water is so heavy. If you think about it, a case of water is pretty heavy, even though it's not that much water. All right, so I'm going to take pictures of this real quick. I'm going to erase it and refill it. If you guys want to, you know, kind of get drinks or whatever, if you want to just kind of get out of the room if the room's too hot for you, whatever you want to do.
Can I erase the board when you're done here?
Sure. We can do that.
I don't know, apparently I have to like perform or something.
Hopefully I don't have to do that because I'm not.
So I'm just playing
with you. Look into that because that's a lot of money.
I know.
You want to raise it?
Oh, yeah. Can I call Jim?
Yeah, you guys gotta like eat more pizza, man. Oh my god, we still have a whole pizza and a half! You guys are crazy, man. I like you, but you're crazy.
There's like three of us.
There's more than three. Maybe you need to go back, figure out how to learn, kind of count.
Okay.
You don't want to erase anymore, do you?
Go for it. Oh,
I erased
the big idea thing. You're
killing me.
Can I rewrite it?
Sure. Okay. Taylor, you gotta eat some more, man.
Yeah.
We need some help on that.
I already had a pizza.
Did you?
Yeah.
Who's your reveal?
Oh,
okay.
Yeah,
I did.
I'm scared for tomorrow because.
Yeah,
We did that, like, thank God.
Okay.
Yeah.
It would have been tomorrow.
It would have been tomorrow?
Right?
Or Monday.
No,
or
Tuesday.
Isn't this thing I get six?
No.
Okay.
I gave myself a shout
out. We're not done with number five yet.
Oh.
What?
I'm going to go shout
yourself out.
Shout out.
Who's complaining about shout out?
Who do you think?
Not Allie B, because she's in the place to be, and she don't ever speak. She's a silent assassin.
She just got a shout out.
That's why I gave one. That's why I gave
one. Patience is a virtue.
Shout out to Charlie, who's normally here, who's not here today.
What?
He wants to be here.
Why does somebody who's not here shout out to Charlie? Hi, Charlie. I don't really know you.
Congratulations, Charlie.
Well, yeah.
Happy birthday, Charlie.
It's
almost
his birthday.
Well,
seems
like it.
Is it a happy birthday? It's like it's his
wait,
birthday.
Wait, did you say
exactly
it's like it's his death.
So the thing is, I need, I should go to Carver Park because I just like, I don't
calm
know.
Yourself. Well, it's about Eugene.
Yeah, true.
Oh so my.
Right there's your shout out.
That was an anti shout out.
Mahan, remember when
did
I made
you
spit out your drink?
Yeah, because you asked somebody if they still had the knife. I asked Meg if she still had it.
No, I asked if she cleaned it.
Yeah.
Man, I went down to
my mom
to eat.
She did.
Jim didn't
answer
my call.
Who's Jim?
My dad.
Oh. Hi, Father McDonald. I'm going to have to pay off 70 grand. That makes it, as you would say, that makes me want to yak. 703.
I'm getting there.
So, like, when does that thing end? Are they just here, like,
yes.
Forever?
Yes.
Wait, they're definitely
pulling
out.
Yeah.
Because,
like, I mean, I can, like, I park, like, I'm going
to
pull out.
Right? I'm going to have to wait.
I have to, like, back out. Like, that's going to end.
Wait, where'd you guys park?
It's over at 10. I don't, 10? I didn't buy
it. It's over at 10?
It's the next kind of
place. Mom is
what? Someone's got to back down. That's crazy.
Yeah,
that's
so
crazy.
Someone back down.
Wait,
is it
a court sponsored to like
in like a random
yeah.
spot?
Yeah,
like,
I have
a gym spot.
Oh my god.
No,
I got a solid.
I couldn't pull through either.
Does anyone know how to back down?
No. Back out for me.
Hopefully I can have a good time.
I was gonna ask, but I didn't want to be mean.
Gonna ask what?
Oh,
she turned
like,
her headlights off.
Yeah, 2 weeks ago when I came for Carbo's review, it's like dark out when I came here because it's like gloomy. So I turned on my headlights and I didn't turn them off. I tried to leave the review, but I couldn't leave because my car wouldn't start.
Oh no!
What?
It was a mess.
That happened to my driver.
Oh my gosh!
So I just made my grandma come.
I didn't want to sit in the car. Are you kidding?
You
left
it
like
there.
Wow.
It was
wow.
Ryan, actually.
Note to self.
Okay, but here's the thing. He's left me at school before. Like, he's just forgotten he had to drive me home. Ryan Marquez.
Oh, Marquez.
Yes. He's like,
Marquez.
Straight up like, forgotten that, like, I existed and just, like, left without me.
That's so sad.
I don't have a driving partner.
Neither do I.
Yeah, lucky.
Yes, we don't.
Do you like have ones and they just don't come?
Perfect.
All right, here
attendance.
We go. We're gonna finish up the idea of numero cinco, and as you can see, we're gonna get into the good stuff with numero six. All right, so entropy. Remember, entropy is delta S. It is not spontaneity. It is randomness. I guess you can think of it as spontaneity. But that was the whole discussion we were having earlier. That's why they switched from saying spontaneous to thermodynamically favorable. Because you can think of entropy as being and just like crazy, right?
That's right.
You get one. Sorry, Gene. Sorry to scare you. That is a legit shout out. Right? So delta S is spontaneous. I think randomness. I think disorder, if you like, system of down type thing, right? So think of it as randomness. Think of it as craziness. It should not be the YOLO of a few years ago. It should not be your reason to do stupid stuff and then be like, you only live once. No, you live every day. You do not, you know, you die once. So, unless you get brought back. You know,
heavy stuff.
Whatever. Spontaneity. All right, so spontaneity, right? It's not necessarily spontaneity. It's just the idea of becoming more disordered, more random, that kind of fun stuff, right? If I have a delta S that is a positive, what does that mean? If I have a delta S that ends up being a positive value, am I becoming more ordered or more disordered?
More disordered.
More disordered, right? Becoming more, as I call it, disordered. You're becoming more random, right? This is the reason why your bedroom always ends up a mess, unless you have OCD. Or unless somebody cleans up after you. So I have a pile of clothes here, a pile of clothes there. You can't find the remote to the TV. Where the hell did my charger go? Or my phone? You know, all that fun stuff that drives you crazy. If you're like me and your wallet, for some reason, always gets lost, right? This also means, if it's positive, that this is thermodynamically favorable. This is what the universe is always doing, at least we think. And well, now there's a recent... studies are showing it's not really expanding at the rate we thought, so what the hell's going on with the universe? We don't really know, right? Delta S, on the other hand, if it's negative, what does that mean? That it's actually becoming
more ordered,
okay? Less disordered. I like to think of it as more ordered, more disordered, that kind of fun stuff, just because it makes more sense to me. If you can think of it as more disordered, less disordered, whatever. If sometimes I've had students in the past tell me when you use two mores, it just becomes crazy. Give me more and then give me less. So I like to think of it as more ordered. I guess you can put below that, right, less disordered. That just sounds kind of weird to me. All right. Your clothes do not just fold themselves on their own. It doesn't happen. All right. Maybe Janet takes care of that for you, but it does not happen on its own. Okay. Once we invent those, Sarah will probably invent them or something crazy. She's on for stuff better than that. You know, she can't be bothered with clothes that are, you know, just like, you know, folding themselves. She's gonna be safe. You're gonna like fix bigger problems in the world than like clothes that like don't fold, right? So that is not thermodynamically favorable. Okay, it doesn't happen on its own. It's becoming more ordered. Let me ask you this question: as I go from a solid to a liquid to a gas, we were just talking about phase changes, after all. As I go from a solid to a liquid to a gas, or directly from a solid to a gas, what does that mean as far as delta S? Very nice. Delta S is positive, right? Delta S is a positive value. It is getting crazier and crazier. The molecules in a solid, they could do it a penguin, right? In a liquid, maybe they can make it a pizza. And the gas, they're crazy. They're pop, drop, and locking it, or they're twerking or whatever the hell you do for fun. I just call it having a seizure, but yeah, sure, okay, whatever, right? Gas down to liquid, down to a solid. What is that telling us as far as delta S? That actually means that delta S is probably going to be negative, right? This is why gases don't just condense on their own. They don't just become solids on their own, okay? They don't just become solids on their own, okay? And just think of it in terms of the molecules, what's going on with the molecules. All right, delta G, a.k.a. give us a free energy. All right, delta G, I kind of think of Gibbs. I think of him as like the judge, jury, and executioner. Gibbs is the one that actually listens to what delta H has to say, listens to what delta S has to say, and it says, okay, either we're going to be spontaneous or we're not, all right? So delta G evaluates both enthalpy, delta H, and entropy, delta S. Sometimes delta H and delta S might agree. Most of the times they disagree. So it's all about delta G to break the tie, right? Break the tie. Overall, right? Overall, it's the overall decider. Decider. Determination. Overall determination of spontaneity, aka, what's the real word we're going to use for spontaneity or spontaneous, aka?
Thermodynamic
favorability. All right, thermodynamic favorability, okay? Do we want a positive delta G or a negative delta G?
Negative.
Very good, right? This is a way of just overall of thinking of the energy overall, the overall free energy in a universe, aka systems and surroundings. In a universe which equals the system and the surroundings. So delta G just kind of takes everything into account and says, okay, is this going to happen or is this not going to happen? right? The big time, the big time, big time, big time. The big time equation for delta G is delta G equals delta H minus T delta S. That's what determines everything, right? That's what determines everything. As you guys just reminded me, delta G, if that is positive, that's a no good. That is not thermodynamically favorable. That means that we are bringing in some kind of extra energy from somewhere. We want negative delta G's. That's what you always want in order to be thermodynamically favorable. Favorable. All right, so if I have a positive delta H and a positive delta S, what's going to happen with delta G? Is delta G going to be positive? Maybe, right? All right, very nice, right? If this is positive and this is positive, delta G could be negative or could be positive. And think about it. Let's break it down by concept. Do we want positive delta H's?
No.
No, not for randomness, not for spontaneity, not for, thermodynamic favorability. Do we want positive delta S's, though?
Yeah.
Yes, right? So this is something that's absorbing energy and becoming more random, which is very normal. But it depends on what in order to determine if it's spontaneous or not. What's the big deciding factor?
Temperature.
Temperature. So if I am both positive, if I am both positive, when will it be positive for delta G? Delta G will be positive at high or low temperatures.
Low.
Very nice. Positive at low T, right? If you have a low temperature, delta S cannot overcome delta H. Does an ice cube melt at low temperatures?
No.
Does an ice cube melt in Antarctica?
No.
No. Melting is a positive delta H. It's a positive delta S, but it doesn't happen at low temperatures. Delta G will be negative at what? At high temperatures. Write your words, Mahan. At high temperatures. Okay? So if they're both positive. Now, some people, they love to just memorize this. They love to just memorize plus plus, always high, not necessarily low. Like, they love to just memorize things. I enjoy algebra, so I like thinking about it. I like going over it. I like thinking and analyzing the math. So I don't memorize, but you do you. All right, so how about the opposite? Not both are positive, but how about if both are negative? Well, what's delta G going to be then? Delta G is going to be positive or negative again, right? It depends again. It depends again. So if they're both positive, delta G is positive at low temperatures, negative at high temperatures. Well, what if they're both negative? Delta G is what at low temperatures? Delta G is actually
negative.
Very nice. At low temperatures. And delta G is positive at
high
temperatures. When do things condense? When does a gas become a liquid? During or at
lower
temperatures, right? Lower temperatures. Okay, this is why if you shower when it's cold outside and if your bathroom's a little bit cold, when you get out of the shower, there's just fog everywhere. It's also because you guys are trying to melt your skin off by showering. You put the freaking shower at like 1,000 degrees. It's crazy.
That's crazy.
It's crazy. You should not be glowing red when you get out of the shower. It's not healthy.
It just makes me feel good. It just makes me feel good.
We're warm-blooded creatures. We should be fine. All right, how about if it's a positive delta H and a negative delta S?
No.
What will delta H always be? Delta G. Delta G will always be
positive,
right? Will always be positive. This could never, ever, 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 ever. This will never, ever, ever be spontaneous. Okay, this will never, ever, ever be spontaneous. How about a delta H that's negative and a delta S that's positive?
Always spontaneous.
Always spontaneous, always negative. Okay, and think about it. We said a positive delta H is no good, a negative delta S is no good. Two no goods don't make a right. Two no goods make a no good. Delta H being negative, delta S being positive, those are the two things that we wanted. Those are the things we like. So, hey, look at that. It's always going to be spontaneous. I'm going to turn these lights on because it's getting a little dark in here. We go back one first. Right now we can see. Okay, cool. All right, moving on. Here we go. Last big idea. Woo-hoo! Let's get it. All right, equilibrium and equilibrium constants and all that fun stuff. Right? It turns out that the majority of reactions, even if they occur so fast, the majority of reactions actually do not go to completion. Most of them do not go to completion. right? So we have to worry about this thing called an equilibrium constant. So if I had this reaction right here, I had a solid that was becoming two aqueous ions. Anybody remember what that's called? When you go from a solid to becoming two aqueous ions, that is? Nice, that's not only dissolving, but that's dissociation, right? Dissociation, aka dissolving, but it's a form of dissolving, right? So for this specific example, for this specific reaction, I'm gonna write a K statement, but what is the subscript for dissolving or dissociation? It's K.
SP.
Nice, KSP. KSP is just dissolving, it's just solubility. Okay, what do we care about for all K statements always and forever? KSP, KA, KC, KB, KEQ, K anything, K your face. The only two things you ever care about are aqueous and gaseous. So I always do products over reactants. So I'm going to take my X plus because it is aqueous and write it there. What's its coefficient? Its coefficient is a 1, so I would. Unlike kinetics when I write rate laws, when I write K values, I do in fact use the coefficient. Okay, I'm just writing the 1 in there to be obnoxious. Do you have to write the 1? No, right? Okay, so that product is in my K statement. How about this product? Should I put that in my K statement as well?
Yeah.
Yeah, buddy. So it would be Y to the negative 1, and again, I could raise it to the power of 1. If I have a large K value, what does that mean? What side is more favored? A large K value means that the products are favored, right? Products are favored, and AKA the forward reaction is more favored. Okay, AKA the forward reaction is favored. How about if I have a low K value, like most weak acids? Low K value, what does that mean?
Reactants
are favored, AKA the reverse is favored. These things would rather be reactants than be products. That's the whole point of equilibrium. That's the whole problem, right? We only care about aqueous and gaseous, right? That's all that we ever care about. That's all that we ever care about. Okay, what would I write down here for the K statement for this guy? What would the K statement for this reaction be? K what? KC, KQ, or since they're all gases, I can also do KP, right? So I'm just going to say KC. KC is going to be what? It's always what again? K values are always products over reactants. Is that product gas or aqueous?
Yeah.
Yes, it is. So I can put it in brackets, and I couldn't put my NH3, and do I just leave it?
No.
No, it's NH3 squared to the power of 2. Over. There's no other product, so I go to my reactants. Are my reactants this time? Here, this reactant was a solid, that's why we didn't write anything. Here, these reactants are gaseous. Do I need to write them?
Yes.
Yeah, buddy. So N2 to the power of 1, H2 to the power of 3. You could also write this as a KP statement. What's different? What's the only difference when I write KCs, KQs, K anything? KP means parentheses and pressure, right? So I'm going to use parentheses. Big P, big time P for NH3 with a subscript of NH3. It's the partial pressure of NH3, okay? And I still square it, though. I still would put a square. I'm going to do parentheses, and it's capital P for N2 to the power of 1 parentheses for H2, and I would cube that. It's the exact same thing when it's a KP. It's just pressure instead of concentration. That's what the C stands for. That's what the P stands for. All right, so the Chatelier shift, we're going to talk about concentration changes first. Concentration changes first, right? I like to think of a seesaw. I think about, okay, if I take a seesaw that's level and I do something to it, what does it have to do to come back to being level? I take a seesaw that's level, I push up on the left, what has to happen in order for it to come back to being level? Got to kind of push up on the right? I have to level that back out. That's the mental, crazy mental image that I come up with. Or you could just memorize it all. So if I increase the concentration of any reactant, I push up on the right, which way is this going to shift? I'm sorry, push up on the left, which way is this going to shift? It's going to shift
right
to the right. So we get a right shift, which means the forward reaction becomes more dominant than the reverse, which means that we get more what? We get more products or more reactants? We get more products. That's one way that you could actually increase your K value, get more products, move to the right. All right, what if I decrease a reactant, decrease the concentration of a reactant, what happens then? Doesn't shift right, but it shifts left. So we always go away from increases and toward decreases. So now the forward becomes less than that of the reverse. And so now I don't get more products, I actually get more reactants, right? How about if I increase the concentration of a product? What if I push up on the right side? Increase the concentration of a product, it shifts back to the left, shifts to the left. So now the forward again is less than the reverse, and again I'm going to get more reactants. You can think about, you can look at the math involved in the case statements and think about how math would have to compensate for it if you want it, or you can kind of just mindlessly memorize. We always go away from increases in concentration. We always go toward decreases. So if I decrease, when Apple starts to sell out of iPhones, they don't just say, okay, no more iPhones. They make more. They call up the factories and they get them going. All right? Concentration shifts. Got to be comfy with them. How about pressure changes? Pressure changes. And how would we actually change the pressure? What did Boyle teach us? We would change the pressure by changing the volume, right? AKA volume changes I have there. All right, so if we change the pressure, what's the only state of matter that affects that pressure will affect? Gases only, right? This will only affect gases. All right, so if I increase pressure, which way do we shift? We shift towards the side that has more gas or less gas?
Less.
Nice. If I increase pressure, shifts toward less gas. In the example we're looking at, the formation, the synthesis of ammonia, which way would this shift if I increase pressure? This one would shift to the
right.
To the right. How about if I decrease pressure? Shifts towards the side with
more gas.
More gas. We have to make up for this low pressure. We have to get the pressure back to where it was. So in this case, if I decrease pressure by increasing volume, what would that do? Which way would it shift? It would shift back to the
left.
To the left, right? To the side with more gas. This only affects gases. Increase in volume means a decrease in pressure. Decrease in volume means an increase in pressure. And what's the last thing? What's the one thing we didn't talk about with pressures? What if I have equal moles of gas? What happens when I increase pressure?
Nothing.
Nothing. What happens when I decrease pressure?
Nothing.
If you have equal moles of gas, no change, no shift if you affect pressure, right? And that's why I think about the way we wrote it. Okay, think about the way we wrote it. Yes?
What was the thing where it was like you shift toward the more moles of gas?
If we decrease the pressure. If I decrease the pressure, I have to go where there's more moles of gas because I have to compensate, right? If I had 100 ATMs of pressure, if I all of a sudden lower that pressure, gases always go from high to low, right? So gases have to fill that vacuum. They have to fill that void that I've now created.
Okay.
So what's going to happen is I'm going to shift wherever I can make more gases to make more of those collisions to kind of hold myself back up.
Okay.
So we always go towards the more pressure, okay? Towards the more pressure. The only other thing that I don't have up here now that I'm kind of thinking about this, and I'm kind of like a little nervous, is what happens if and when we shift for temperatures. Right? If we increase temperature, which way does it shift? It shifts towards the side that is endothermic. I feed the endothermic. So if I increase temperature, I shift whichever way. Coming back to here with wherever we had on the previous board, when we had enthalpy, as I increase temperature, I increase and I enable the side that is endothermic, aka positive delta H's. If I decrease temperature, which does that feed? That feeds the exothermic. So whichever way is exothermic, right? Whichever way is exothermic. I'm sorry, I forgot about writing that on the previous guy. All right, reaction quotient. Reaction quotient. I don't know. I want to write that. down with temperature.
Damn it. Let me sneak it in there. Temp changes.
Increase in temperature shifts toward endo, aka delta H is positive. Decrease in temperature shifts toward XO, aka negative delta H. What's the other thing that's very interesting about temperature? It's the only thing that can do what? It's the only thing that can change the value of K, K's value. It's the only thing. Doesn't matter what else you do. The only thing that will ever change K value is by changing temperature. I mean, you can put temperature up, you put temperature down, whatever. All right, reaction quotient. Here we go. Reaction quotients. All right, reaction quotient. K is Q, Q is K, but we just don't know where we're at. They love tagging this on. They love throwing this in there. They love making this a part of things when they, maybe in an open-ended at the end, like which way would this shift, or if you did it at these concentrations, which way would it shift, that kind of fun stuff. So it's literally the exact same thing. It's the exact same thing in terms of the math. Q is K, K is Q. You would set it up the same way as we did here, right? So this, instead of being KC, this would just be Q. Instead of being KP, this would just be Q. It's literally the same math. So what does it mean if Q is less than K? If Q is less than K and the math is the same, that tells me that my numerator is low. If my numerator is low, how do I get a higher numerator? Which way do I have to shift? I would have to shift to the... I'd have to create more products to increase the numerator and then also actually decrease the denominator at the same rate. All right. How about if Q is greater than K? Well, if Q is greater than K and it's the same math, that then tells me that my numerator is too big, my denominator is too small. So how do I decrease my numerator and how do I increase my denominator? I actually shift back to the left. What if Q equals 10? Nice. You are at equilibrium, ladies and gentlemen. All right. Common ion effect. Common ion effect. Right? If we have a species, watch it. We have a species that's reacting. Specifically, we usually talk about common ion effect. We talk about precipitating things out and either increasing solubility or decreasing solubility. Right? By throwing extra ions in there, we can get things to precipitate out. We can affect concentration. This is kind of actually how we do the Le Chatelier shift thing, right? This is actually how we do that Le Chatelier, as they say, hockey, let's do that hockey, right? As Chan said for us and put it for us perfectly, right? So by adding an ion that is in the reaction, we can affect equilibrium. We can also affect solubility. We can affect equilibrium, and in this case, we're talking about KSP, so we're also talking about solubility. So, silver nitrate. Does silver nitrate really like to dissolve? Silver's a medium, it's a meh, but nitrate is Mr. Soluble himself, right? So it's soluble only because of the Mr. Soluble, only because of the nitrate, the N and Na, and your CHOPS Na, right? So with that nitrate, okay, this would be dissolving. Well, it shouldn't surprise you that KSP for this is actually very low, and the KSP for this is 3.6 times 10 to the negative 3. Okay, 3.6 times 10 to the negative 3. So if I were to add in something like, oh, I don't know, calcium nitrate, would calcium nitrate affect this solution? Would calcium nitrate donate an ion that would maybe interact with or maybe is in common with the dissociation of silver nitrate? Does calcium nitrate have an ion?
Yeah.
Yeah, right? Actually, this would be a big time effect because calcium nitrate would give me 1 mole of calcium and 2 moles of nitrate. So if I increase the concentration of nitrate, what is that going to actually do to the solubility of silver nitrate? Is it going to help the solubility of silver nitrate? No, right? This is going to shift left, aka decrease solubility.
Solubility.
What if I were to throw in something like sodium carbonate, Na2CO3? What if I were to dissolve that? I get 2 moles of sodium, and I get 1 mole of carbonate. Carbonate doesn't really want to dissolve. Silver doesn't really want to dissolve. So when I throw sodium carbonate in there, what does the carbonate do? The carbonate finds the silver and goes, hey, you want to be here? Nah, man. You want to be here? Nah, man. Screw this. Let's get out of here. And so actually, the carbonate would bond with the silver and precipitate it out. So if I precipitate out silver, what am I doing to the concentration of silver? I'm actually decreasing the concentration of silver. If I decrease the concentration of silver, what does Le Chatelier say? If you decrease the concentration of silver, if you decrease concentration of a product, you're going to shift to the right. And if we shift to the right, that means more of this has to dissolve. So what does that mean in terms of solubility? That actually means it's going to become more soluble. That's how we truly use this thing called the common ion effect. By using solubility rules and by using equilibrium, we can manipulate and make things more or less soluble. That's like very high level because you got to think like 3 layers deep. What the hell is that going to dissociate into? Okay, now that you dissociate into these ions, will you actually mess with these ions? What the hell is the CHOPS NOT rules? Sons of Scotland. Okay, got the CHOPS NOT. Okay, what's the Le Chatelier shift? Okay, Le Chatelier shift is this. Okay, what the hell does that mean? More product, less product. Those are tough questions, but they do ask. Okay, acids and bases. Here we go. Acids and bases.
What's probably trying to say? Yeah. Okay. Good.
Yes.
So basically, when you think about it, if they ask, they tell you like, oh, you're adding this to it.
Mm-hmm.
You think about it, not will the ions that you're adding dissociate, but will one of them bond to one that can't and precipitate?
Yeah, in a way. You are looking at what happens when the ions dissociate. And then you're going to look at, okay, so in the first instance, I'm going to have calcium. Well, calcium is never going to bond to silver anyway. So the calcium in nitrate and nitrate, so at first there's no actual interaction. But even though this isn't going to necessarily precipitate out the silver, I am increasing a product. So if I increase the product, I shift left.
Yeah.
Okay? The second one, the sodium, again, isn't going to affect the silver at all. And so the sodium is an alkali metal. It's very soluble. So it's going to dissolve and it's going to be there. The carbonate, however, that's the C in CHOPS NOT. Carbonate doesn't really want to dissolve, but sodium's like, I love dissolving! Dissolving's the best! I'm going to dissolve all day, every day! And so carbonate's like, oh, screw you. And then nitrate's like, me too! I love dissolving too! Let's dissolve for, let's go to the gym, we'll get matching uniforms, oh my god, matching yoga mats, yes, right? They're going to do whatever the hell they do. I have no clue, right? They're going to do whatever they do. But when that carbonate now bumps into silver, carbonate's like, I don't want to do this. And silver's like, I don't want to do this either. So now, even though it's not technically a common ion, it will affect this ion and decrease. So really, this isn't a common ion example. I'm just trying to show you how we also throw in some other ions and some other things that can affect one of the ions and therefore change the... Yeah, so this is kind of a bad common ion because it doesn't share something in common, but this can still affect the solubility, so I thought I'd sneak it in there. Okay, great question. Acids and bases. First guy up was this dude Arrhenius, and he had like an awesome definition for acids and bases. What did Arrhenius say? Acids do what? Acids
donate
what?
H pluses.
Awesome. He then said that, well, for every yin, there's a yang. For every hot, there's a cold. For every light, there's a dark. So if there's an acid, there's a base. What did Arrhenius say bases do? They
accept H plus.
Aha, gotcha. Wrong. You are wrong.
Yeah.
He actually said that you donate H or you donate OH. Silly Arrhenius. Tricks are for kids, right? In comes NH3, aka ammonia. What was so special about NH3, aka ammonia? It was acting like a base, but does it donate any OHs? No. So in come Bronsted and Lowry, and they actually turn around because NH3 acted like a base. They come in, Bronsted and Lowry, two completely different parts of the world, two completely different labs, find out the same thing, and they agree with Arrhenius. They're like, you know what, Arrhenius, you're right. Acids, they do in fact donate H's. But it's not the fact that the base donates the OH. That's not what makes it a base. What makes bases a base? Got it, Jane. Say it correctly. You got it. You said it last time.
They accept H+.
They accept them. They accept H+s. So what Bronsted and Lowry shifted the discussion from, okay, what do you donate, what do you give, to what it really is. That H, this hydronium ion, these H's, when they find water, water is no longer water. Water becomes hydronium. It becomes H3O plus. So it's all about that H. Powell, I mean, come on, that's all about the H. But it's all about the H because that H plus attacks water and actually changes its geometry, changes its physical properties, and more importantly, its chemical properties. All right, so that's why they expanded upon it. All right, ready for one more quick little break, and then we'll get into like just how to calculate the pH and titration. Buffers, pH, titration. Okay, real quick. So I'm going to take some pictures, and then we'll rock and roll. I'm hoping to erase it and have it written in 5 to 10 minutes, and then I could probably burn through in like 15 to 20 the rest of it. So we should be able to stop right around 8. But I might need a couple more minutes, but you obviously guys are free to go whenever you want and everything else. But I know Carbo's gonna be pissed.
I guess we'll let you slide.
Sorry,
what
are
Carbo's
on?
Yeah,
I should have gone to Parma Burger because I came for the big wait, what are they doing today?
I'm sorry.
I don't know.
I'm gonna be
all that. I'm gonna get like a 2 on the count. And I'll get like 5 and 8 subsequent. It's gonna happen. Like I know.
Well, did you catch up on
no.
Like Taylor series and the phone series?
No.
That's like the only thing that like.
I know. I need to learn them. I really do.
It's okay. You have like 2 weeks.
Yeah. Like
that. I'm just gonna push that one off.
Like,
it's like,
but I'm just gonna like. I don't know.
I should be fine. Like a lot of it, like you can just kind of figure out like vectors and stuff. That was like.
Well, I learned that though.
Like
parametric stuff.
Yeah.
I learned that. Don't you only need to know how to like find distance and like speed?
Yeah.
And
it's basically first derivative, for second derivative.
Yeah. That was the best.
Yeah.
But polar, you guys know polar?
Yeah.
I didn't learn that.
Polar was like
computer. It wasn't that bad.
Like,
it was kind of.
I don't know why. It was one of those things where like I didn't understand it, but then like when the testing and just all like came together, it was super easy.
It's kind of like
it's chi.
It's kind of just
like
the same as finding the area like
knowing
where the graphs
like,
are like a little different.
It might be weird just to find the bounds.
Did they give you the graph?
No.
That's what I have to.
Like, it was like, you like to get to the zero and then find the like parameters and it's easy. Then you just like use the.
I looked it up and it's like the thing of like half r squared, right?
Yeah.
But I don't know how to find the limits of the integration.
You just
set
equal to zero.
And
set the function to zero, and then
that's it. For like all.
Yeah.
Unless
it's like
two
graphs,
yeah.
Then you set them equal to each other.
Oh, that's not bad at all.
No, it's not. And then like, there's like a different thing. Like,
isn't there like one question on it?
I don't even know.
I feel like it's not.
I feel like there'd only be one open-ended.
Yeah.
And then even if you don't know, you could still
but
get
I think it's either,
like
my sister said it's either polar or parametric. Like it's.
I hope it's parametric.
So I really hope
it's what was it last year? Hopefully it's.
We did like a really good open-ended from 2016 that like I want to.
And they don't actually. It was so good.
Oh,
the one that we did.
Yeah. What was it at all? I just remember like I was
probably perfect.
It was
Huh?
I'm really not going to. Yeah,
and
like I went in and I was like, I know what
I
I'm
knew what to expect.
Like, I know.
And now
yeah.
I really don't.
Yeah.
I know that there's
like,
one essay where you pick a book.
Thing, but like,
there's
one at least.
There's a poem?
Apparently, well, did you guys read the poem?
Wait,
we had to read a poem.
Do like all of
it?
She was read a poem.
Oh, yeah.
She was like, I read a poem every day.
Yeah, wait, I know that there's one about a poem.
Wait a second.
One about a book.
You do that?
What's the third
book? I
think
essay you guys wrote.
But there's
like one about a book.
You have to choose our own book.
choose our own book.
Which one?
Is it Passage?
All
right,
all
right.
You know
that
you guys wrote, like, recently on a poem?
The poem?
Yeah. I didn't do that.
I didn't
take
part 6 crown punishment.
I haven't taken 3, 4, 5, 6, or ever.
I don't sign on Zoom.
I don't know. Like,
she'll probably forget.
Like, I don't really want to ask. I really haven't taken it anyway. I took part 1 and 2. And
it's gonna be like June, like 20.
Take this.
Dress code.
Who's
dress code? I don't know.
Mahanika?
Mahanika?
What?
Hatrakovna Mahanika?
What?
Melodol?
I like when Josh calls you that.
Yeah.
When he does what?
Josh calls Mr. Mahan,
Mr. Mahanikov.
Or,
that's
Patrikovna Mahanikov. Except sometimes he mixes up the first name.
Wait, what did the middle name be?
Okay. I'm not up to date on my Russian.
Okay.
On my Russian.
Like, no
bitch.
You got me.
Patrikovich. Mahanikov.
I don't know what happened in that vlog either. All I know is he goes to jail. That's
gotta
He goes to jail.
He like what?
You think she can make a statement?
I don't know.
She goes to jail.
Part 3.
He falls in like legit love with Sonya, and they're like together.
And he's like 7 more years. So
yeah,
that's all you have to wait.
So oh, and his mom dies.
Yeah, she just dies.
Yeah.
All right, so here we go, guys. Let's rip.
Oh,
let's
yeah.
Rip.
She exists.
Let's rip and rip. All right, so here comes like all the really, really good stuff, right? Save it for like the actual absolute best, right? So so here we go. So with pH, remember that pH stands for potential hydrogen, right? Potential hydrogen scale. pH is not pOH, all right? pH is pH. Some of you guys got caught on that on the final exam. You for the caffeine, you actually find the pOH and you guys subtract it. So remember, pH is negative log of H, which also really is the negative log of H3O plus. Okay, really is the negative log of H3O plus. But for every one H, I get an H3O plus. Remember, another formula is that pH plus pOH equals what? They put this on your reference sheet, but it is pH plus pOH always equals 14, right? And so pOH is the same thing, but instead of negative log of H, it's the negative log of OH, okay? pH and pOH are the potential scale. This 14 comes from water. The equilibrium constant for water is 1.00 times 10 to the negative 14. That's the kW for water. That's where 14 comes from. Because if you were to have all OH, it would be 14. If you had all H, it would be 0. And what that is if we were to take water as a liquid, and if we were to separate it, if we were to separate it into its constituent ions, H plus and OH, we would get a KW, that is the concentration of H, times the concentration of OH minus, and that's where you get the KW being 1 times 10 to the negative 14. So it's really like X times X, aka X squared, 1 times 10 to the negative 14, the square root of that would be 1 times 10 to the negative 7. So that's why pH 7 is neutral. It all comes from water. Water is actually what we call amphoteric. It can do both. Okay, it can do both. Every once in a while they ask you about this fun fact of water. It's just kind of more for like people that like really care where the hell did the whole pH thing come from. It came from that. All right, so here we go. Let's get it. Let's get it. Let's get it. Strong acids. What makes a strong acid strong? Boom. Strong acids are strong because they completely dissociate. It's not that they're dangerous. They are dangerous, but I could take a strong acid, I could put a couple drops in your water, you'd never know, and you wouldn't die, you'd be fine. Conversely, I could take a weak acid, make it really concentrated, and kill you with it, right? So that they completely dissociate. HA, that is a solid or a gas or a liquid or whatever, usually aqueous, is going to all become, actually there is no equilibrium, it's only a forward reaction. It all becomes H plus and A minus. So if I had 100 HAs to begin with, and I had 0 and I had 0, oh my God, an ice table? We're not really busting the ice table out just yet. But if I were to actually dissolve a strong acid, every single molecule of HA becomes H plus and A minus. Every single one. Every single one all the time. That's why there's only a forward. That's why we can use stoichiometry with this. But more importantly, what that means as far as calculating pH for strong acids pH is the negative log of H plus, aka H3O plus. But because all of it dissociates, because all of what I have originally as HA becomes H plus and A minus, for strong acids, pH is like the easiest thing in the world. pH is the negative log of really the acid itself, whatever the original concentration is. That's why in the final exam, in where they gave you five different acids and they said which one was the strong acid, which one's hydrochloric, it was the one whose pH was really, really low, because almost all of it doesn't dissociate, all of it becomes H plus. That was actually acid two, if you remember the question specifically. Mm-hmm. Anybody remember the five strong acids?
HCl,
hydrochloric acid, is one.
H2SO4
is one. What's very interesting about H2SO4? It's polyprotic, it's diprotic, it's got two. Only the first H. Only the first H is strong. Okay, so that's two of them.
HBr.
Hydrobromic, yeah, there are some books that say hydrobromic. That's kind of like a cousin. I usually don't include that, but technically you're right. Which one?
Perchloric.
Not chloric, not chloros, not hypochlorous. HClO4. All right, so that's three. Nitric.
Mr. Soluble,
right? Mr. Soluble, why does it not dissolve so much? Because they like to dissociate, right? There's no HA. At equilibrium, there's no HA. It's all H+. Okay, there are your strong acids. Chloric, perchloric, nitric, sulfuric, hydrobromic. I feel like I'm forgetting one.
Iodic.
What is it? Hydroiodic is kind of, it's like hydrobromic. Some people say yes, some people say no. Here are the other ones. Hydrofluoric is not. So we'll put a hydroionic on there too, but HF is not. Why not? Why is HF not a strong acid?
Oh, because H is in it.
What?
Electronegativity.
What about electronegativity?
The F is really strong.
The F is so damn strong, it doesn't let the H escape. So it's actually a weak acid. You're right there. I'm saying stuff. All right, so a weak acid. What makes a weak acid weak?
Partial
dissociation. Barely dissociates at all. Barely dissociates at all. HA, now we have equilibrium. Becomes H plus and A minus, and this is aqueous, and that's aqueous, and everybody's aqueous. I might have started with 100 HAs. I start with 0 Hs and 0 A pluses. We're going to have the minus X. Uh-oh. Dun, 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 dun. Ice, too cold. Too cold. Right, so here we bust out the ice table, the ice table, baby, right? Ice, A, I, and C. What does the I stand for?
Initial.
So I might have 100 of it initially. I lose a little bit, so I have 100 minus X. But what did we say? We say X is so flipping small that it will what? That we could just ignore it, right? I maybe had 100 HAs. I maybe have like 98 at equilibrium. You still have 100. Okay, you still have a freaking 100, right? But we do now all of a sudden have that X as far as our H plus and that A minus as far as our conjugate base, right? And it was Bronsted Lowry that brought in that whole conjugate acid base pair. Understand your conjugate acid base pairs. HA is the acid, A minus is the conjugate base. HA and H plus are not the acid base pair. Acid, conjugate base, okay? Acid, conjugate base. There's partial dissociation. They have K values. They usually have Ka values, which are usually very small. That Ka value is telling you, look, listen, this is a weak acid. It does not like to dissociate. Very little of it actually dissociates. And the problem with weak acids, and this is why they're so flippin' annoying, is that the concentration of H plus does not equal the concentration of HA. And a strong acid, yes, that is the case. And a weak acid, no, it's not. That's why we bust out those ice tables, and that's how and why the ice table saves us, right? Here's our ice table. What would be the Ka for this acid? What would the Ka statement be? Ka equals concentration of H plus to the power of 1 times concentration of A minus, the conjugate base, to the power of 1 over concentration of the acid itself. Now, here's the thing. pH doesn't change. pH is pH. pH is always the negative log of H. for a strong acid, that's awesome because HA is H. H is HA. It's the same value. So for pH, pH equals negative log of H. Okay, well, just negative log of the acid. But for a weak acid, those concentrations are not the same. For a weak acid, this is what I need. Remember what we did for this? This is where I take my ice table. This is why we have ice tables. Because I think about what I actually have at equilibrium. We wrote a Ka. We wrote an equilibrium statement. So if you remember, we turned this into x squared over the concentration of HA. Remember doing this? Equals Ka. But I want x. Because if I find x, x is H plus. X also, by the way, is your concentration of conjugate base. So they could give you a problem where they ask you what's the concentration of conjugate base. Well, solve for x. So I make it x squared over HA equals Ka, but I want to get x all alone, x squared all alone. So I multiply by HA. Whatever I do to one side, I do to the other. And so for basically every single freaking weak acid ever, you always end up with x equals the square root, because I'd have x squared, so I would just take the square root of this. Whatever you do to the one side, do to the other. X equals the square root of Ka times the concentration of HA. That's always what X equals, which is always the concentration of H and or the concentration of the conjugate base. So I would plug that in to my pH. pH equals the negative log of X, aka pH equals the negative log of the square root of Ka times HA. All right, for weak acids, that's why we busted out the ice table. You actually really don't need the ice table. What you need the ice table for is here when we do titration, because that's when you actually know what X is going to be. For weak acids, here's what it's always going to be. The negative log of X, aka the negative log of the square root of Ka times the concentration of HA. That's what it always ends up being every freaking time. Every freaking time. That's what it is. Okay? Every time. Every time. I usually hit the board, and the board is like soft and like gives. I think this is not good. Don't do that. Don't do that. One other last thing is about maybe a little bit. Maybe, although I heard you so.
What?
You said, are you concussed?
Yeah.
The other last thing to keep in mind, I mean, it's kind of self-explanatory with the partial dissociation thing. HA, the concentration of HA is always going to be greater than the concentration of your H pluses or your A minuses. Okay? Of your H pluses or your A minuses. What does it mean to be polyprotic?
Polly wants a cracker. You guys should get along very soon.
Polyatomic law. Polyprotic, right? Polyprotic means that it donates more than one H plus. Poly, whether you're diprotic and you give two, or you're triprotic and you give three, right? H2SO4 is the only strong polyprotic acid, and it's actually only the first H that is, in fact, strong, okay? The first acid in polyprotics, first H is the highest in concentration. It's really the only one that you ever have to worry about for AP chemistry. At higher levels of chemistry, not PChem, but advanced analytical chemistry, you would use the first H, the second H, and the third. For this, we just worry about the first H and the first H only, because the first H, like ionization energy, is the easiest to remove. What does it mean to be amphoteric? Nice. Can act as an acid or a base, right? Can act as an acid or a base. Water being like the most popular or the most well-known amphoteric species. If I throw an acid, do as you oughta, add the acid to water. When I throw the acid into water, I get H3O, which is now that hydronium aqueous ion, and I get its conjugate base, which is that A minus ion. Okay, here's my acid. Is HA, it's going in as HA, comes out as A minus, it loses the H. So this is my acid, Water is going as H2O down to H3O plus. And so water is accepted in H. What did Brunson Lowry say? If you accept H's, you are a
base,
right? This A minus is my conjugate base. I'm going to put C base. That's my conjugate base. Water's acting as the base. And so what water becomes is its conjugate, and conjugates are the opposite. So that becomes the conjugate acid. Weak acids give what strength conjugate bases? Weak acids give us
strong
conjugate bases. Strong acids give us weak conjugate acids. That's that whole salt acting as an acid or base thing. If you were to throw the ammonia in there, the thing that both Bronsted and Lowry understood, if you throw ammonia into water, a little bit different of a scenario occurs here. You now get NH4 plus, which is ammonium, which is one of the A's in CHOPS now, which you by the way. And NH3 this time is going in as NH3 and comes out as NH4. It had that lone pair and that trigonal pyramidal shape, that lone pair sitting up top, it accepted an H plus. So what do we call that? If you are accepting an H plus, you are a base, and then this would be its conjugate acid. Weak bases give strong conjugate acids. And in this case, water is acting as the acid. And so this is what it means to be amphoteric. The fact that in one situation, depending on who water's with, it might act as a base, as it does when you throw an acid in it, or the fact that it could actually act as an acid if you throw a weak base in there. Okay, an acid if you throw a weak base in there. The conjugates of polyprotics, they too are amphoteric. Okay, conjugates of polyprotics are amphoteric, yes.
The polyprotic acids, like when we draw like the titration curves, I think it is, they're the ones with like where you can count the steps.
Multiple humps mean multiple ages, yep. And remember, they always dissociate in a stepwise manner. There's your steps that you were talking about, in stepwise manner. Right? H2SO4, what am I talking about? H2SO4 gives one H, and then becomes HSO4 to a minus one. Then it's going to turn around and give, later on, the other H plus, and become SO4 two minus. All right, great question. So you'd have two humps there.
Yeah.
Two humps. Okay. All right, moving on. Here we go. Last like two columns. We're almost there.
Forever.
Right? Oh my God. Buffers, right? How do we create a buffer? This question got a bunch of you guys too.
Yeah, I was gonna say that'd be you, Abbott.
Weak acid and
this is where I made up chemistry. Mode.
And it's conjugate or a weak base and it's conjugate, right? And buffers, I think of them as superheroes, and I think of buffers as superheroes because they have both, right? The middle school answer for a buffer is something that is able to resist large changes in pH, right? It does change. But it doesn't change drastically. This was that question as to what happens when you throw the stuff together. What they love to do is give you like a weak acid and say, okay, with that weak acid, you threw in a strong base, usually about half. So that means half of the acid has gone from HA to being H plus and A minus. So I have half H plus, half HA. You've actually created an ideal buffer. You've actually created a perfect buffer. So the reason why it resists large changes in pH is because whatever you throw at it, it has one. You throw an acid at a buffer, right? If you throw an acid at a buffer, throw acid, what part of the buffer activates? Very nice. If I throw an acid at a buffer, the conjugate base is going to be the thing that eats up that acid. So because it eats up that conjugate, that's why we don't change it largely in pH, because I have something to counteract you. What if I throw some base at a buffer? What part of the buffer then activates? The acid, right? It's just the yin to the yang. It's just the yin to the yang. The most ideal, the most effective buffers has an equal concentration of acid to equal concentration of conjugate base. I want equal concentrations of both. That's the perfectly ideal buffer. Because then I have the majority, I have equal at 50-50. So I have a ton of acid that could eat up those bases we're throwing at it. I have a ton of base that could eat up that acid I'm throwing at it. And there we go. What do we use? What's that magical equation we use when we deal with buffers? Nice. David Hasselhoff's long lost cousin, Henderson Hasselbach.
Whoa.
Hasselbach. Anybody remember it?
No.
Is it negative log? I'm trying to use the one that is.
It's positive log of HA.
Nice. No, positive log conjugate over.
Yeah, man.
Carlos had to be done at 8. I'm just longer to do that.
Yes, yeah, he goes till 9.
Yeah,
because he doesn't even know how to do math.
Not efficient.
He doesn't even,
right?
Exactly. Although, I'm going to be going a little bit past 8, but that's okay.
You guys are killing
it. Yeah, we're doing what we can. Yeah. So, this again is. This again is on your reference sheet. I usually do the minus acid over conjugate, but on the reference sheet they give it to you as plus conjugate over acid. You do you. You fill that out however you would like to. Okay? When you get to what's called the half equivalence point, half EP, half equivalence point, that's when you've created that ideal buffer, because now you've eaten up half the acid, half of it is acid, half of it is conjugate, right? And at that moment, at the half equivalence point, at that ideal, the concentration of acid and the concentration of conjugate base are the same. So what's the log of 1? The log of 1 is 0. So at the half equivalence point, at that ideal buffer point, pH equals pKa. So if you wanted to create a buffer of a certain pH, you create an ideal where its pKa is close to that pH. They gave you the Ka values in that question. You had to do it. Right, you had to do it. All right, here we go. Last two things. Titration. Right, titration. So when we have titration problems, here's the whole deal, right? We know the volume of what we added. You know the volume and the molarity of the titrant, which is the stuff that you're adding. You know the volume and you know the molarity of the titrant. That's the whole point. I know I added exactly 32.3 milliliters of 0.5 molar NaOH. So what we're going to do is we're going to always, the first move is to always multiply the liters of titrant by its molarity. And you want to do that because what is that going to give you? When you multiply liters times molarity, what do you get? You get moles of titrant added. Well, the moles of titrant added, usually it's a 1-to-1 ratio, equals moles, and usually you're always titrating with a base into an acid. So usually the moles of base added, not just titrant, so the moles of titrant, the moles of the base, equals the moles that you started with in the sample, and that's usually an acid. I don't want to write acid, I don't want to write base, but it's what you had to begin with. The whole point is I don't know what I have to begin with, but if I know how much I added and I know its molarity, I can use some stoichiometry and rotate that way and I can work that way, right? So if I added 25 milliliters of a strong base to a weak acid, and that strong base had a 3.5 molar NaOH, that's what our strong base was, right? I know HA is gonna react with that NaOH. And here's the beauty of titration, ladies and gentlemen. When you titrate, you are forcing a weak acid to act strong. You are forcing a weak acid to dissociate and to become this thing we call NaA, to become the salt water. Acids that are strong and weak, it takes equal amounts to titrate. That was another question that beat everybody up. Yes, a weak acid is weak, but if I'm pulling it out, if I'm constantly eating up these H pluses, I'm decreasing the amount of H, I'm shifting farther to the right, and so as long as I titrate to the end point, to our indicator, I've eaten up all of the acid, and so that I made that weak acid become strong. So it doesn't matter if it's strong or weak. If you titrate to the end point, if a strong and weak acid have the same molarity, they will actually be the same or will take the same amount of acid. Okay, it will be the same or take the same amount of acid. So if I wanted to figure out how many moles of acid I had to begin with, I would take that 25 milliliters of NaOH. I get that into liters by dividing by 1,000. I then take my molarity, 1 liter is 3.5 moles. I multiply the 1-to-1 ratio. 1 mole of NaOH gives me 1 mole of HA. And if I knew the volume of HA, I could take the moles of HA I originally had, divide by original volume, and guess what? You just found the original molarity of your weak acid. You just found the original molarity of your weak acid. Okay? 0.5 molar HCl, 0.5 molar HClO2, chlorous acid. 10 milliliters, 10 milliliters. It's the same volume, same molarity. It's going to be the same moles. You need the same volume of base to neutralize. All right, and that's at the end point. That's at the end point. Okay? If you do a strong acid and a strong base, you get a perfect pH of what? We wrote this down last time. Strong acid, strong base, neutralizes each other. It's a perfect neutralization of
7.
How about a weak acid with a strong base? pH higher because you're going to have that conjugate base floating around. All right, you're going to have that conjugate base floating around. All right, here we go. Last thing. Woohoo. A weak acid with a strong base, you'll have a pH above 7 because you're going to have that conjugate base. All right, what is this a titration of, this first one? This is a titration of a strong acid by what? By a, so this is strong acid by strong base. How'd you know a strong acid by strong base?
It
doesn't have the buffer region. Midpoint's around 7. We started with really low pHs, right? So this is a strong acid by a strong base. What do you need to know, right? This like completely vertical slope, this like infinite slope, that's the equivalence point. At the equivalence point, the concentration of OH added equals the concentration of acid originally, and we've now created a perfectly neutral species that is going to have a pH of 7. All right, a pH of 7. Okay? That's really all that you need to know. Why doesn't this jump up right away? Well, because all the acids are already dissociated and there's a lot of it, but see how it is kind of kind of completely linear and then does take off a little bit. Okay, the end point will also always be at 7. What is this a titration of? That's a titration of
weak
acid with a strong base. And I guess my equivalence point should have been higher. I didn't really draw this to scale, but this is a weak acid by a strong base. What's important? Okay, well, here's my equivalence point. Again, my equivalence point is the amount of OH. What's equal? The amount of OH. I've added enough OH. I shouldn't say concentration. Don't. My bad. Oh, that's so bad. So bad. I'm sorry about that. Moles of OH added equals the moles of HA I had to begin with. Moles of OH added equals the moles of HA I began with. Okay? Mole of HA that I began with. But what's also very interesting about a weak acid with a strong base, this pH is now greater than 7.00 because you have that conjugate base present. Okay? Yes.
So you know it's weak because it has that buffer region.
Has the buffer region. Has the buffer region right here, right? It's exactly going to be my next part. This is a buffer region. Let's say that this was 20 milliliters. This is 10 milliliters. What's so special about that point? This is the half EP, and what did we just say over here about the half EP? At a half EP place, I don't know how I put it, I'm trying to go too fast and furious, right? This is actually an ideal buffer, okay? Before the half EP, what do you have more of, HA or A minus, or H plus? What do you have the most of? You have HA concentration, is greater than H plus, which is also our concentrate, or really our conjugate base. Conjugate base.
Is it concentration or moles?
Concentration at this one. Yeah, concentration. All right, at the EP, what's special about at the EP? We just kind of said it, but you've created an ideal buffer because the concentration of acid equals the concentration of A minus. Right? After EP, I'm sorry, half EP. After half EP, before the actual EP, you now actually have less acid than you do conjugate base. And at the EP, no acid left. No acid. It's all conjugate base. There's no even H plus left.
And then that's why you've now broken the buffer and it's gone off the rails. What is this a titration of? What is this a titration curve of? Strong base being titrated by a strong acid. How do I know it's strong base by strong acid? It starts really high, no buffering region, and it's going low overall. Same thing but opposite. Only thing you really care about here is the EP, and that's going to be at 7. This is a weak base by a strong acid, and we'd see everything equal but opposite, that this is our buffering region. This is our EP. It's a little bit less than 7. And this would be our half EP. And so we'd say all the same things but opposite. Okay. The thing that makes acids and bases so freaking obnoxious is the fact that the weak ones do not completely dissociate. So we can't just do easy math. We have to use the ice table. If and when you titrate this amount that you're adding of the titrate, when you do this moles times liters, that's the value for X that you could actually fill into your legitimate ice table, 2-fold, 2-fold. All right, how are we feeling?
Good.
Wow. That was a lot. That was a real lot today. But again, as always, thank you guys so much for coming out. I appreciate it. We really got to meet you. You guys may have impressed Mr. Brown for me, which I appreciate. Awesome stuff. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
You're going over. No, thank you. If you're going over to Carbo, tell me smells.
Okay.
There's flowers. I'm looking for it.
Come on.
But tell them I said hello.